coming. It's definitely a trip for me to be here, simply because I remember taking classes in this very classroom, actually. And so today we're going to talk about making things people want, and sort of we're going to talk about YC a little bit. We're going to talk about kind of my experience with it, and towards the end I want to go really deep into some of the most surprising lessons that I had, both as a founder and as a partner at YC. So I was an alum, and I was, you know, just graduated back in 2003. It's hard to believe that it's been over 10 years, actually. So when I first came onto campus as a freshman, it was actually 1999. So kind of the center, the middle of the first web, you know, the first internet boom. And I was kind of totally convinced that I would end up either starting a company or joining a company right out of Stanford. But, you know, 2001, 2002, the crash happened. And so what's crazy now, speaking in 2014, that, you know, basically in 2003, we thought the internet was dead. Maybe not the internet overall, but we thought the web was dead. We literally thought, oh, it's over. And so when I graduated, it was kind of the nuclear winter for trying to go work for a startup, actually. And so I ended up at Microsoft. And I said, you know, if the web's dead, well, what's not dead? Mobile. And I managed to get a program manager position at Microsoft back in 2003. And I was a level 59, lowest of the low, straight out of college PM for the Windows Mobile organization, which was a really exciting time because it was clear to me, well, mobile's going to be the way people use computers, actually. And the difficulty there was that they assigned a lowest of the low, you know, level 59 PM, the task of owning all of the kind of personal scenarios, so photos and music sync, the things that, you know, when the iPhone came out, that was really the thing that really made people go, wow. And not only that, the reason why they assigned the entry-level guy to it was because nobody there wanted to work on it, actually. And so that was a really interesting time. And so Stanford being Stanford, it turned out that some of my fraternity brothers here at Phi Kappa Psi, they actually started a company right about the time I was about a year into my stint at Microsoft. And they didn't even know the name of it quite yet. They were thinking of calling it Palantir. And they were starting it with Peter Thiel. And so one of the things that they always did that was so great when they're starting a new company, Peter encouraged his co-founders for Palantir to go after their friends. And I was basically lucky enough to be one of those guys who had grown up with Stefan Cohen and went to college with Joe Lonsdale at Palantir. And so here I was, level 59 PM, just a year out of college, and I get a call from my friend saying, hey, Peter Thiel wants to fly you down here. And the next thing I know, and this might have been maybe the month he wrote that check to Facebook. It was right about that time. I was sitting face-to-face with Peter, and he said, Garry, what are you doing at Microsoft? You're wasting your time. Come join us, and we're going to change the world. And I've been told since that I was one of the few people to ever turn down Peter Thiel to be so pigheaded. And so I turned down the chance to be the first engineer at Palantir, which is one of the crazy things. Anyone who spends any time in Silicon Valley has a story like that. They say no to the thing that was ridiculously huge. But don't feel bad for me. Better late than never. I ended up keeping in touch with my friends, and later on they hired away one of my favorite, one of my other smartest friends, and I said, you know what, better late than never. So I joined as employee number 10, got to build a great V1 product for them, and so that was really cool. I got to see what it was like to work at a really big company, a big tech firm. I got to see what it was like to build products from scratch at a super fast-growing startup. And for me, you know, going back to 1999, when I first stepped foot on this campus, I said, you know, I really want to start my own company. And so in 2008, we applied to YC with an idea called Posterous, dead simple blogs by email. It was kind of crazy to try to start a blog platform in 2008. That was maybe 10 years too late to start a blog platform. But our hook was that you could post by email. And this was right when the iPhone had come out. And there wasn't, you know, I think the there basically wasn't a great way to get media off the phone. And so post by email coupled with that helped us build a great company, raise multiple rounds of funding, and it was acquired by Twitter. And that was kind of how I got to know YC. They literally gave us our first capital, and they gave us our shot. And so it's also a huge trip, just as it's a huge trip for me to be here in this classroom where I was sitting right there in one of these classes. It was also a huge trip to join YC, first as a designer in residence, just helping people with product. And this was in 2011. This was right at the cusp of where everyone in the Valley started really, really hearing about YC. But we'll get to that. Let's talk about YC for a little bit.
Garry, did you get in?
Oh, please. Oh, thank you so much. Wait. Oh, actually, okay. So, what is YC? In a nutshell, twice a year, we invest a small amount of money, relatively small amount, into a large number of startups. And what we believe is if you're the right kind of person, you can change the world with just the right kind of help from the right kind of people. And we do this in batches. There are two batches a year. We have a winter batch that's just about to start that we've just selected. That's January through March. And we have a summer batch that's June through August. And so the standard YC deal is $120,000 for 7% of the common stock. And so we're common stockholders just like the founders. So we've actually selected 105 companies for the next batch. And so over the years, we've actually funded over 800 companies, 85 in the last batch and 68 in the class before that. And so YC is a huge community of founders at this point. There are over 1,600 founders who have been through the program. And our companies, many of them maybe you've heard of, Dropbox, Airbnb, Pebble, Heroku, Stripe, Twitch, which was recently purchased by Amazon for over $1 billion. HomeJoy and Coinbase, Instacart. Some of these are, you know, fast rising names that are actually still very new. So if you sum up all of the total valuations of all the companies that YC has funded so far, that'll add up to $30 billion. And so that's actually $3 billion, actually now multi-billion dollar companies, and about 20 or so that actually exceed $100 million. And we kind of think of it as a Peloton that's gliding on its way to billion-dollar status, at least a few of them, we hope. And so what's different? What makes YC different? Well, a lot of people talk about incubators or accelerators as, you know, a co-working space or a place. And that's not how we think about YC. So we actually don't give room and board. We don't give office space. And there's a very specific reason for that. And that is focus. And so let me tell you, being someone who has worked at a fairly big company, or even as an employee at a very early stage startup, it takes such a total different mindset shift to be able to be your own founder. And we don't think how you do that is by going to a co-working space that has a water cooler, that has conference rooms, that looks anything like your old life as an employee. To be a founder requires such a fundamental shift and a change that you actually need to focus. And so a lot, and this is going to be a recurring theme of what we try to do with YC and what we try to do to help founders become founders. It really starts with being able to help founders focus. Really change how you work and what you work on. And so what is YC actually? In terms of the actual program, it's a lot of face time in the form of office hours. So this is kind of embarrassing because that's one of my office hours. But This is what an office hours actually looks like. You know, right before a dinner, that's kind of our old space. It's right across the street from our new space in Mountain View. And as you can see, lots of founders are around. This is what it looks like on a Tuesday night, right before dinner. And so we sit down, there are about 20 or so partners who kind of spend time with the companies, whether it's product, design, engineering, legal, finance, anything. We spend a lot of time with our founders in basically one-on-one settings like this. There's very little instruction, and that's because every problem that a startup faces is not generalizable. The other part of YC is group office hours, and they look like this. And so one of the things that we realized was because we were funding companies in batches, the companies ended up being themselves among the most eminent founders who were starting companies at that time. And they were all seeing basically the same problems all at the same time. And so I know it kind of looks like an AA meeting, but that's because we actually do want to support each other. That's what the founders actually do. You know, the partners are there, that's Paul Buchheit right there. And you know, we try to guide the discussion, but often the most interesting discussion in these group office hours is actually the founders themselves helping each other out. I need a partner, I need, you know, press relations at this firm, or you know, I'm trying to figure out how to sell to so-and-so. Someone in the group will just, it'll turn out, oh, that's my college roommate, or oh, I work with that person, or I can get you that connection, or I know how to do that because I've done that. And you know, this is a recurring theme. Like, it's not just the partners who help, it's also the whole community itself. And of course, there are dinners. This is basically from YC right at the beginning when you know, Paul Graham himself would just cook the dinners at the first Summer Founders programs. We still do that. Weekly is about the right amount of time, it turns out, for YC companies to meet. And that was true for us when I did YC. It turns out that you want to basically be working on your startup, you know, 6 days, 6.5 days out of the week. And then, you know, you need a little bit of downtime, you need a little bit of socialization. And like dinners once a week, that's about the right level for us. And so what we would do is basically code, talk to users, build product, you know, all of the other time. And then we'd, you know, clean ourselves up and show up at dinner. And we'd meet our other meet the partners, and we'd meet the other founders. And of course, you know, again, what you're doing at the dinners is going over, hey, this is what I've been working on this week. You know, people will bring laptops and actually show off, okay, this is what I've done, what have you done? And if you show up empty-handed, well, that's a little embarrassing. And so after dinner's done, we usually have a great speaker lined up. These include alumni, like these are the Airbnb guys, and it's such a powerful moment when they can get up and stand on stage as, you know, founders of among the most successful companies in Silicon Valley, and they can say to you with a straight face, I was you 3 years ago, I was you 4 years ago, I was sitting in your position, and this is what we did. And so YC itself, in terms of the actual programming, the dinners, the office hours, and all of that, that's about a 10-week program. And at the end, it all culminates in demo day. And so this is an event that happens twice a year. And pretty much every Silicon Valley and tech-oriented investor sends a representative. You know, if you're an angel, you know, basically, this is the place to be. And the amazing thing is, people are actually even raising huge Series A's right out of demo day. And so this is kind of the thing that we really drive for all of our founders. You know, what is the reason why you're working? Why do you have to get users? Why do you have to build your product? Why do you need to make your revenue graphs grow? It's because of demo day. This is such a forcing function, but that's good. That's actually fantastic because people actually basically accomplish the impossible. They accomplish things that they themselves don't think that you know, they don't think they're possible. And that was true for us as well when we went through YC. So for this batch, actually we've had a huge rise in the number of applications this time. Over 5,000 applications were received for this current batch. And we actually read those applications. And so, you know, the really crazy thing to think about YC is that this is actually an open submit form. This is actually a web form that anyone on the internet can basically walk up to and submit, like, you know, film a 1 minute video, talk about your business. And the questions are very straightforward. You know, what is your business? Who's your market? Why are you better? And so, you know, even for companies that don't get in, the process of asking those questions, those are actually the right questions for you to ask yourself as you're building this business. And so the really crazy thing to think about these applications is that for most investors, you need to come with an intro. Like, that's why, and we'll get to this later on, like, this was one of the most shocking things that drives why YC companies end up being successful. It's not about who you know anymore. It's not about what school you went to. It's not about what prep school you went to. It really is truly one of the great equalizers. Anyone who has access to the internet can ask these questions, put together a product, get feedback, get users, get traction. And that's really different. And so we actually flew 450 teams to come meet us. And you know, many of them were alums or friends of alums, or you know, a lot of them did come in through the people we knew, but a good number of them we had never talked to ever. We probably met them through Hacker News even. And so we meet them for about 10 minutes. And what's crazy is that's actually enough to be able to tell, okay, is this going to be something that's going to work or not? And so out of that 450, we accepted about 2% for this next batch. And so it's kind of crazy, but it's actually harder to get into YC than Stanford or Harvard, and that boggles my mind. About 28% of the founders actually of the companies actually have at least one female founder, and about 20% of the startups are actually international startups. So yeah, of the last batch, 74 of those founders were actually not born in the United States, and they came from 27 countries. The reality of it is, a lot of people think, oh, why, you know, I want to create the YC of, you know, this country or that country. And what we want at YC is we want YC to be that thing. We want to be able to accept founders from all over the world, no matter where they are. And we want them to come to Silicon Valley and absorb the knowledge and the insights and the capital and the know-how and the networks. And take that back with them. And that's happened over and over again. We see founders come from all over the world, come to YC, raise money, build their YC network, they're, you know, of both investors and other founders, and then they go back and they thrive in their own home markets. So one of the big questions I get often is, am I too early or am I too late? And basically, you're never too early. We continue to try to accept companies that have basically no traction, who have teams who have never done it, because that's ultimately, you know, those are the people who create truly great businesses. It doesn't matter. That stuff doesn't matter. You know, a lot of companies actually have already raised seed capital, you know, of a million or half a million or, you know, 1.5 million. And what we say is, we're still helpful to you. We're actually helpful to any company up until Series A. Once it's Series A, well, you know, you have a board and you kind of set on your path. But we've been able to help companies like Thelmic, which came along and raised over 10 million from Spark Capital right out of demo day. And they had only raised, you know, a seed prior to that. And so YC is helpful. Both early and up until having raised Series A. So there were a lot of really surprising things for me to come to YC, and I just wanted to kind of run through the most surprising parts, the parts that I don't hear anyone talking about when it comes to acceleration, incubation, about, you know, how to help founders, how do we really create companies that really matter? And I think, you know, you guys are here at Stanford. Everyone's kind of heard this, but it's like the degree to which this drives everything just is truly shocking. And that is basically that startups conform to an extreme power law. you know, that $30 billion total valuation for YC companies, three companies, Dropbox, Airbnb, and Stripe, are 66%. That's two-thirds of all the valuation. And that's true across basically every portfolio out there. And so one thing that is also crazy is YC itself is kind of a an example of this power law too. YC is the only incubator that's actually shown, both in terms of valuation and exits, significant multi-billion dollar sort of ability to create companies. And so what does that mean? Well, if you're operating a power law sort of ecosystem, then what you have to do is have a different strategy. And so what we're actually doing is searching for those black swans. We're looking for things that, you know, happen very, they're the most extreme outliers. And one of the things we have seen is we have to be okay with failure. A lot of people out there do it wrong by saying, you know what, we're gonna shoot for 100% zero failure rate. We can't possibly allow anyone to fail. And if you're in a black swan power law sort of distribution, that's exactly the wrong kind of strategy, because what you're going to do is cut out all the things that actually will get, will grow to be truly great. And you know what? We have to be totally fine with being early. No traction, and this is actually really hard. As YC itself has grown in kind of reputation, it's one of the things that we have to remind ourselves all the time. If there's no traction, if it's just an idea, if it's just a demo, there's no, you know, revenue ramp, there's no user ramp, it's okay. What matters is we have to, you know, the team has to be great, the idea has to be something that we see happening. You know, and in the same way, the team itself, Airbnb essentially, before it did YC, it actually got turned down by almost all the angel investors out there. And that's the thing. You know, it's tough to spot these outliers. It's tough to spot who will actually create something, you know, that has that level of capability of changing the world. And so the reverse example is also interesting, that, you know, could Airbnb have been created by people who worked all their careers in the hotel industry? Maybe not, because maybe they wouldn't have, you know, done things in a different way. And so we also have to be okay with ideas that seem crazy. Like Bitcoin is a great example. Bitcoin's something that we ourselves found out about through Hacker News, and a lot of other people did too. And it was still kind of tinfoil hat land when we first invested in our first Bitcoin companies, but it turned out that was the right call. And so things that seem crazy, the things that really change the world, they start off as crazy. And so we have to be okay with funding things that seem a little bit nuts. And, you know, Dropbox is a great example of having to be okay with competition. It's okay if this has been tried over and over and over again. Instacart's another example where a lot of people who first heard that pitch, they would say, well, oh, didn't people try that? It was called Cosmo. Didn't people try that? That was called Webvan. And so if you're not willing to try that, then things like Instacart can't happen. Instacart ended up happening because the founders really impressed us by actually having built it, and we'll get to that in the future, in just shortly. But they also figured out that what smartphones in everyone's pocket meant was that they could actually do that service without the crazy capital overlay. And so just because it was tried, just because there's competition, doesn't mean we should say no to it. And so this is actually the first batch of YC back in 2005. And the crazy thing about the black swans is that we didn't know that there were any, but there were. In that very first batch, Twitch was in there, and they were an inexperienced team right out of college who had never run companies before, never shipped consumer software before. Their first startup in this batch didn't work out. They ended up selling that. But their second startup, which was just in TV and then pivoted to Twitch, recently sold for $1 billion. And that's the kind of crazy thing that we want to continue to fund. you know, tomorrow's Justin Kahns and Emmett Shears are sitting someplace in this room or watching online someplace. And that's why we want them to come to do YC. Oh, and Reddit was in that first batch too. And, you know, in 2005, nobody would have been able to call that Alexis Ohanian and Steve Huffman would be creating a site that would go on to turn into one of the top 30 websites in the world. And so the next lesson comes directly out of that. Basically, when you have to be okay with black swans, when you're looking for people who have never done it before, or people who have very non-traditional backgrounds, well, it turns out that founders are everywhere. They don't come from this mold at all. You know, they're basically from every background. It used to be that, oh, you need a business guy. You need an expert, you know, you need a person who looks like this or plays golf at this place. All of that is not true anymore. And as you can see from our stats around how many companies are started internationally and, you know, how many founders aren't born in the United States. Like, the founders are actually coming from all over the world. So back in 2005, when Paul Graham started YC, he actually filmed a great YouTube video, quick interview, and this was one of my favorite pieces of that. It's that, you know, and to a certain extent, I feel like this is one of the things I most like about Y Combinator, and that's that starting a business is kind of like playing chess. Business is like that. There are a few rules of business that hackers are actually capable of learning. And once they learn them, they'll get as good at it as the business guys. Ultimately, hackers can be business guys. And, you know, today we fund founders from all sorts of backgrounds, all sorts of, you know, walks of life. But, you know, in 2005, that was a new idea. That wasn't something that was, you know, to the forefront of what investors were thinking. And so I really like that. The other thing that is clearly happening is that more and more people are realizing, well, it's way more fun to be a pirate than join the Navy. And this is one of the pieces of mental calculus that definitely was clear to me back when I was at Microsoft. And that's just in terms of revenue per employee. And so, you know, some of you are pondering what your next jobs will be coming out of grad school. And a lot of people are pondering, well, maybe I should go work at, you know, at the Google or the Facebook or the Microsoft. And this graph is something you should keep in mind, because essentially this is a measure of the amount of value that as a product person, as an engineer, as a marketer, as someone who's going to go actually be the person who creates these technology products and these companies and gets it in the hands of users, that's actually the value that you create. And if you're in the product and engineering sort of side, like, you know, it's a multiple of this. And basically, that's the value that you could be creating for yourself only if you own the equity and you start the thing yourself. And so not only is it more fun to be a pirate, it's also a lot more lucrative. And so this is almost too obvious at this point, but when YC first started, it wasn't clear. You can start for way less. You can start meaningful companies with almost no capital. And that's because right when the internet was new, back when in 99, nobody knew how to program anything for the web, and no one knew how to set up the servers, and you had to buy the servers, and you had to buy the, you know, basically it would be $2 or $4 million just to even get to market. And now, you know, and largely starting in around the mid-2000s, all you really needed to do was cover the cost of rent, food, and your cloud servers, and you'd be off and running. And this is kind of spreading to other fields too, where hardware itself, even a few years ago, you couldn't imagine something like Pebble really getting funded by Silicon Valley VCs. But now with crowdfunding, you can show product market fit and get the capital to build the thing all in one step. And, you know, while this is somewhat obvious, you know, what does that mean? Essentially, less funding needed, plus way more potential founders. Basically, what that means is we believe there are way more viable startups out there. And so a lot of VCs claim that there are only 10 companies per year that really matter. And so what we hope with YC is that we want to help find and nurture 10 companies that wouldn't have. You know, we actually want to increase, we want to manifest that. We want more viable startups to actually exist. And so one of the common themes, one of the recurring themes in how YC itself is structured is actually it does take a village. And this is something that I've seen a lot. I spend a lot of time meeting with founders, and to be totally frank, it's a lonely existence. It's a very, very difficult thing to do, to try to create something that has never existed before. And one of the things that helped me as a YC founder was that I was never alone. I meet a lot of my friends weren't YC founders, and I wish that they could have what I had. It basically takes a village to be able to create these things. And it's very straightforward. I mean, I think a lot of you like are familiar with this. If you go to a conference, if you go to your friend's startup party or whatever it is, you know, what everyone wants to hear is, you know, oh, how are you doing? And basically, on beat, immediately, you have to answer, awesome, killing it. Like, that's, you know, it's ultimately not helpful at all, right? Like, and this is basically the common and standard case for most founders is that, you know, most people you can't trust. And that's really upsetting. That's horrible. And that's why it's such a lonely and emotionally draining, difficult existence, right? I think it was Elon Musk who said, basically, starting a company is like eating glass and staring into the abyss of death. And, you know, maybe not literally, but, you know, I think in large part that comes from this loneliness, not being able to be truthful with even the people who are, you know, supposed to be there. And so this does actually influence how YC thinks about how to structure the how we do, you know, YC itself. We actually don't have mentors. And so you'll hear a lot of incubators talk about, we have, you know, 100 mentors, 1,000 mentors. We have, and they have this huge, you know, everyone has this huge long page of, you know, face, name. We're pretty wary of that because often, many of those mentors, how do you know they're good? A lot of them aren't very good. And the other thing is, a lot of them are not very trustworthy. You'll tell them something and they'll, you know, like it'll come pop up someplace else. I mean, it comes back to that trust aspect. And so for us, YC has no outside mentors. We only have partners and we only have alums. And that's how we get the community, we get the village to be a village so that you can actually, you're basically honor bound to keep secrets. And so, you know, what is valuable? Like, the secrets are actually valuable. How do you do things? Who's good? Who's not? Who should you hire? What vendors should you use? How do I talk to this investor? You know, how to hire, how to get users, you know, how to raise money, how to do anything. Basically, the thing with YC is that out of those 1,600 alums, someone out there, possibly a whole bunch of them, have actually done that 10,000 hours. And the way it works is that when you're in YC, people help you. If you're in the batch, you can email any founder who's gone through YC, and they're honor bound to help you because people helped them when they were just first starting. And that's one of my favorite things about YC itself, that, you know what, you're not alone. One of the more surprising things that I just feel like no one really talks about, actually, but is very true, we spend a lot of time working with founders trying to get them to undo bad habits. And the number one bad habit basically is don't do things that feel like work, but it isn't work, right? Here's what is work. What is work is this: writing software or hardware, you know, building the product. That's work. That's real work. Getting users, getting customers, like, that's real work. Here's what isn't work. It's schmoozing, it's going to conferences, it's being a scenester. A scenester is kind of like the worst possible thing you could get called at YC, basically. It's someone who is always talk and no action, right? And here's a very subtle point that I think actually results in more success for founders. And that's don't always be fundraising. One of the things we're very clear with for our founders is that you can't really do you know, a good job fundraising and actually build the company at the same time. And this is, you know, anyone who's tried to do it, you're never able to actually build the company while also fundraising. Like, your numbers always go flat. And, you know, this is one of the big dangers out there. I see companies die all the time because simply they're alternating. There are too many holes in the dam. They don't have enough fingers, basically. And it goes back to that first point. You know, great startups really, really have to focus. And with YC, the great thing about Demo Day is that nobody has to worry about fundraising until Demo Day. And Demo Day all happens all at one time. And so, you know, the community itself, it gives you the know-how and the networks. And then you get to basically focus on your product, your traction, your idea, your team. Those are the things that make your company grow. That is actually building it. And everything else is noise. And we, you know, to be frank, like, we spend a lot of time, maybe even half of my time, sitting down with companies is helping them figure out, well, what is noise and what is really building the product? What is really building the business? You know, and basically the best ones really do spend almost all of their time on that. And it's a great luxury for YC companies to be able to do that. So, final lesson, really, and this is broadly shared among the YC partners, the most surprising thing, seeing this volume of startups, is actually to what degree every single startup, even the ones that you read about, even the hot ones, they're all basically huge messes on the inside. And so, actually, it's kind of like being a Stanford undergrad, I hear. You're basically a duck floating on the water, but deep down you're paddling really, really fast. That's basically, everyone else is like that too. It's, you know, don't worry, it's not just your startup, it's everyone's. And so here are kind of the three main killers that we see kill companies and kind of, you know, what we try to do to help. The first one is actually really straightforward. It's just actually not making something people want. And one of the things we really try to do with the companies that are going through the program, it's totally fine to change your idea. In fact, some of the best companies have. There's a great company that a lot of you guys probably use called Order Ahead. It's on, you know, you probably see the little placards at all of the restaurants in downtown Palo Alto. They actually tried, what is it, 5 other ideas before they found that one that really stuck. You know, Codecademy is another great example of a company that came in with one idea, and midstream it just wasn't working. They had to throw it out. And, you know, Zach and Ryan said, you know what, we're going to work on a prototype this weekend. I don't know if it's going to work, but let's put it out there. They put it online, and they got 100,000 people using it that weekend, and it basically set the course of their company. And so, if you're not making something people want, you really, really need to change. You know, how do you know if you're making something people want? Essentially, we've spent a lot of time trying to get people to talk to their users, actually talk to them, be open to changing your idea. And in the end, you know, you have to keep trying new things. These are so simple, but they're the basic things that, you know, I do spend a lot of time repeating. And in the end, there's not really a silver bullet when it comes to getting users and, you know, finding that thing, finding that product market fit. The next thing that we see that kills so many companies is actually team problems. Whether it's just being a single founder and just losing steam, or it's getting a little farther along and then losing co-founders along the way. It's that probably the number two thing that kills startups. And, you know, for us, we spend a lot of time helping people, you know, understand, well, they do need a co-founder. Again, going back to how lonely, how similar to eating glass starting a company is, having a co-founder is like having a partner who, you know, when you're down, they can bring you up and vice versa. So much of this is actually an emotional game, and having a co-founder, not just, you know, just for the emotional sake alone is worth it, but beyond that, in terms of having more capability, being an expert at more things, being able to do more, that's so valuable. The other really big mistake we see people make over and over again is not making it close to an equal equity split. And what that means is, you know, someone starts working on an idea, and then a month later, they add a co-founder and they decide, well, since I've been, it was my idea and I started working on it quite a bit earlier, well, let's make it an 80-20 split. And that will actually kill a company, and that has killed companies over and over again. And the simple fact is, most of the work early on is far in advance, right? The idea is merely a multiplier on your execution. And so when you're trying to create something truly great, the vast majority of the work is far in advance. And these things are so binary that it doesn't matter, like 10%, 20% here or there. Basically, you should think of it as zero or one. And whatever you can do to make it a one, you know, will greatly increase your chance of success. And this was something that Kirsty recently said at Sam's Stanford class, that it turned out that exactly zero of any of those really successful YC companies that we've funded have highly unequal equity splits. So we have quite a lot of data around it. And so the final most surprising killer, actually, is that startups don't actually die from some sort of colossal, you know, mistake. Like, you know, it's not some day, it's one day it just implodes. That almost never happens. Really, startups fail and die just by fading away. They just kind of, you know, stop talking to people. They stop, and then, you know, maybe they move away, and then nobody hears from them again. And so that's where the community kind of comes into play. What we want people to do is actually keep in touch with that, with your alums, with the other people who are in your batch. And this was true for me. I got married a few years ago, and you know, out of about 15 tables, two of those tables were my YC alum friends, like the people who I actually started companies. Like, it was like going to boot camp with them. Like, we had fought a war together, and you know, that's one thing that is one of the best parts about YC. And you really are the average of your closest five people, the people who you spend the most amount of time with. So not just having co-founders, but also having the people around you reinforce all of these things. You know, what should you focus on? What should you be working on? You know, going back to the point, it takes a village. And then, you know, the final point really is that these founders, they're not alone. The partners and the alums are there to help. And so relying on that is very, very important. And so really, this is more or less what we spend a lot of time doing. We try to help people make something people want. We really spend a lot of time with team trying to soothe out a lot of the, you know, consternation. Like, honestly, I remember my first day of YC, Alexis Ohanian came to speak, and he said, look to your left, look to your right. You know, those co-founders of yours, you guys are, well, married without the sex. So, and it really is true. Like, these are the people who you're going off. You're basically going off into a, you know, you're like going off on a boat deep into the sea. And these are the only people who you have next to you. So having great co-founders, people you trust, who, you know, really are equal co-founders, it's one of the best ways. And in the end, don't slink off and go quiet, you know. Rely on, you know, your community, and a community matters. And so that's basically what we spend a lot of time doing at YC. We really hope that what we do will help make a lot more startups happen. And so thank you for listening, and I'm happy to stick around for questions.
Garry, that was fantastic. I want to get to ask the first question, right?
All right.
So this is about international things, and my question is, I would think that people who are not born in this kind of an environment, who are founding something somewhere else, would have a real disadvantage compared to the people who are here and used to Silicon Valley. Do you see ways in which they're overcoming that before they come to Y Combinator, or how do people with you know, basically startups from somewhere else
definitely
get into this system?
Yeah, definitely. Well, you know, I found out about Y Combinator through Hacker News, actually. So I don't know if you guys haven't seen it. It's news.ycombinator.com. It's basically a tech news aggregator, but you know, it's got an extremely like over half of the users don't live in the United States, and they more or less visit the site regularly every single day, and so that's a really great way to kind of absorb a culture. And you know, even for me, I had worked at I had worked at an early stage startup, and I had gone to Stanford, but I kept learning brand new things from Hacker News and sort of the stuff that was on there. I mean, the other thing is like, well, basically all of these things are actually on the internet now, and so that's one of the best things. If anything, when I meet founders who are from all over the world, and you know, we fly them out for the interview, and we're just hanging out and chatting. I ask them, well, how do you find the Bay Area? And they say, well, it's just kind of like hanging out on the internet, but just in real life. And so I like that. I think that that's really encouraging. It really doesn't matter where you are in the world. Like, it, you know, Silicon Valley happens to be the place where it happens to be the most concentrated. Like, you can go to a cafe and overhear people talking about JavaScript or something like that. But, you know, it really is more so on the internet already.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. The floor is open. Go for it.
What do you pass that was that turned out to be successful later?
I'm sorry. Oh, what did we pass on?
We did pass on and turned out to be a success.
I think we missed on SendGrid, but I wasn't there for that. I'm pretty sure, well, the reality of it is all investors make pretty major mistakes all of the time. And so if you ask basically any investor what their anti-portfolio is, it's any successful company. A lot of the successful companies that aren't in their portfolio. So yeah, I don't know. I think that's a tough question for any investor.
Okay, good. Next. Go ahead.
What do you think is the big differentiator between the Black Swan in your group and the rest of the startups that go through Y Combinator?
It's a good question. You know, the hard part is it's unclear. There might not be anything. If you go by what Sequoia Capital likes to talk about, it's actually the wave, right? And I think there is probably something to that. Like, what idea you end up picking matters so much, possibly more. Than your own individual skill. And they like to talk about riders and waves, right? That, you know, if the wave is truly great, you know, even if the rider of the wave isn't very good, like, still they can work it out. And so it's unclear. When people fail, they tend to fail for, you know, those kind of three reasons, right? They basically ignore the data that it's not working, right? And they don't want to change. Or team things kill them. Or basically they give up, right? And so it's tough to say, like, those are the things that happen. But inherently, I don't think there's anything, you know, there usually isn't anything right when we're working with them that clearly can show, well, they're going to fail or they're totally going to succeed.
Can you tell us a little bit about the process of how 4,500 companies are narrowed down to 400 interviews and then narrowed down to the ones that you actually invest in?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Well, like anything, well, luckily YC is started by a software engineer, so we get to build our own software for it. And so there's basically no way we would have been able to do it without software. So that web form goes into our databases. We actually, you know, use a lot of our alums. We asked a lot of our alums to come in and help us read applications. And so we actually asked them a very simple question, which is, we don't ask them to say yes or give a grade. We just say maybe. Maybe there's a chance. Basically, the two buttons they get are maybe and no. And you know, the reality of it is that's kind of about as good as you can get from, you know, a 5 to 10 minute read of an application.
Yeah. Do individual partners kind of take on a company that they say will let in? I mean, is there anything where you have a special responsibility if you
definitely
say, I think we should go with these people?
Well, some of it's random, and then some of it is, you know, if there's a company that we really like, you know, often we personally advocate. But going back to how it goes, so the alums read it, then the top 1,000, every single partner reads at least 3 to 5 times, and we actually do give it a letter grade. infinite, meaning we're definitely actually interviewing them. If we really want to interview and we don't care whatever anyone else says. A minus if we do, and B plus if I don't really need to, but if someone else does, I'm cool with it. And then anything below that is I don't want to interview.
They don't make it.
But it turns out, it's actually a really tough process. And kind of crazy to see that number of people and that number of ideas out there.
Do you find a lot of divergence of opinion, or do people really kind of come to the same conclusion?
So what's cool is actually we want divergence. And I think Google found this in their hiring studies too. If you want things that are truly outlier, then the more controversy, the better, actually.
Okay. All right, great. Back to the floor. Back in the back, I saw your hand first.
So how are great product ideas formed or found? Do they kind of come in like moments of inspiration, or are there more methodical ways of coming across a great product idea?
Well, there's so many ways. I guess the two ways that we see that are most common are scratch your own itch or kind of Altair Basic. Actually, they're very related in that respect. So scratch your own itch is essentially that, right? Like, I wanted that thing. When I worked on Posterous, that was true. You know, I found it difficult to blog. It was kind of a pain. You had to learn all this software. And sometimes all I wanted to do was fire off an email from my phone. Altair Basic is especially interesting because, things like Bitcoin or drones, like those are, very much down that vein. It's that, Altair Basic is how Microsoft started. And, it's tough to believe that one of the greatest tech monopolies of our time came out of two guys making a hobbyist language for a hobbyist platform for Altair. It's like nothing serious. Like, you could, and they found out about it through reading Popular Mechanics, right? And so things that technically minded people are doing for fun, it turns out that's kind of where the future is getting made.
Okay, I saw a hand down here.
Versus non-technical. I guess, like, how essential it is to be extremely technical to be a Y-combinator
co-founder. We usually try. Like, what we're finding is actually, it's 2014 now, and so many of the things that you really need, it might not be totally 100% absolutely necessary to have, it won't kill you to not have a technical co-founder. We used to be a lot more strict about that, I would say. But it helps, right? Like, we especially love founding technically minded founders. And I mean, if I had to guess, maybe 80 or 90% of the teams have at least one technical co-founder. Yeah, the majority do. But it's definitely not a deal breaker.
I saw several hands.
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead.
In the 1,000 or 450 or so proposals you're evaluating, you're evaluating written proposals, not face-to-face interviews?
The 450, we actually do, fly them to Mountain View and meet them for about 10 minutes. So that's all face-to-face.
What are you looking for in that personal interview?
What's crazy is one of the most important things is communication. Can they actually, in a very short amount of time, in a very high-pressure sort of situation, explain concisely and clearly what it is they're trying to do and why it is that they're going to succeed? And that time pressure actually helps a lot, because if they can't, well, it's unlikely that they'll be able to do it out there anyway, given infinite amount of time. Essentially, when you're trying to do something new, you're basically giving that pitch to everyone all of the time. And if that's not very good, then you can't turn it into the magnet it needs to be to attract capital and customers and all of that.
Okay, go ahead.
Garry, when Yuri Milner, through DST Global, invested in every company in the entire batch, did that change the thought process of other angel investors and other institutional investors?
Well, I think of Yuri coming in as actually kind of the moment when the investor community itself decided YC is a thing that is spawning these thunder lizards, or the companies, one or a couple of those companies that really matter. That was the moment when Silicon Valley really said, oh, okay, one Dropbox, oh, that might be a fluke. Airbnb, oh, okay, like, this is something that's happening. And now what we're seeing is this giant pipeline of companies that, you know, are becoming among the best in the valley on a regular basis, which we're excited about. So, I mean, it's tough to say, is it correlation or causation?
I follow up. So your alumni base is growing, right? Are you scaling up and adding more partners along with that? And what's the process from going from alumni to partner?
Well, I think historically, you know, YC itself was up until 2011, basically Jessica and Paul Graham full time on it. And then they added Harjeet Tagar as, you know, first outside partner, and then it kind of grew from there. And so we're kind of figuring out what that process is as we go. But generally, we're bringing on alums. And so our best founders who have done really great, who we've seen over a long period of time, they're kind of like the ideal people to come on and help at YC.
Okay. Do you think that the YC model could be franchised?
It's a good question. I don't think there are any plans for that. But,
yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Your 7% equity pick, would it be diluted after Series A, or do you have any provision to go against this?
So we do get diluted. And, well, I don't know what's going to happen after in the future. It's possible something might change there, but, you know, no specific plans right now.
But it's a standard amount, right?
Yep.
Standard investment amount and a standard percentage.
That's right.
Okay.
Oh. Of your international founders, how many of them are building products for either local or regional markets in Asia, and how are you able to assist them through your partners? That's
it. Yeah, definitely. As advisors, we basically try to help them figure out what would be best for the company. So if that means building a product for their home market, then that's the right thing for them. And so we'll help them with all the other things, whether it's raising money or building product or, you know, design or, you know, whatever it is they need help with that. And, you know, obviously we can help them enter the U.S. market as well pretty easily in terms of connections with PR and press and all of that. So whether or not they attack a U.S. market or not, it's basically up to the company. But we basically try to help in any way that, you know, makes sense for them.
Garry, I'm going to ask you to give a plug. I think we first got to know each other when you were an officer in the Asia Pacific
That's right.
Student Entrepreneurship Society, ACES, which is still going strong now.
Definitely.
How did that help you in what you did?
Well, I mean, the great thing was I got to work with Professor Dasher.
This has been a paid political announcement.
That's right. You know, I mean, it's a club here on campus, basically helping people learn about entrepreneurship. And I sure did learn a lot by, you know, organizing speaker events. And we also have a yearly summit at, you know, we bring among the top engineering and marketing and business students from Asia, and then, you know, they come to Stanford and they actually stay with Stanford undergrads and grad students and kind of really get a feel for what it's like to be here. And so in the same way that we want YC to be this thing that, you know, helps founders from all over the world come and absorb the best of Silicon Valley, mm-hmm. that was what we were working back in the day. And that club continues here on campus, ACES Stanford, and they've got a great summit series that's coming. And actually that was one of the biggest first introductions for me to entrepreneurship overall. I remember coming to a ACES summit event where you know, the students from other countries were presenting what the entrepreneurial climate was like from their home countries.
The co-founders, what if some technical co-founder is not that good at the communication?
We definitely try to make sure that all the founders are there, and if not, well, I just had to hop on the phone with a founder the other day to make sure that, you know, to check it out. So it's fairly important for us to talk to all the founders, just because the founders are the team and the team makes the product, right?
And you're also watching team dynamics, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Some of the companies, it sounds like pure software, but what's the biggest technical risk? Or can you give us some examples of where you invested in a company with more technical risks, something like a Tesla? Or, I mean, maybe that's sort of out there, but...
Yeah. I guess one of the biggest... one of the biggest companies to take on a lot of technical risk is probably Meta. It's glasses for augmented reality. And, you know, it's a huge risk simply because the computation and the devices themselves are just barely reaching a point where they're really, really, you know, usable and getting to the point where consumers might, you know, might be willing to buy. And, you know, the hard part about that stuff is, well, how do you know if it's going to work? For them, they managed to actually hire more or less all of Steve Mann's graduate students, and they've actually been able to get exactly the right kind of talent to put around that idea.
As kind of my segue was, how do they clear that bar in a 10-minute interview when, if you know, they say, we've got this much technical risk, does it take, do you give them a little more leeway in the interview to explain why it might work?
Well, normally we try to get to a yes or a no within those 10 minutes, but for things that are a little bit more complicated that couldn't possibly be evaluated in 10 minutes, we definitely spend more time.
Okay, back to you.
What's the oldest founder that you founded? And in general, the more important question is like, what's the correlation between age and entrepreneurship?
Yeah, it's a good question. Let's see, I believe our oldest founder is in his late 50s. And so, I don't know. The reality of it is we basically try not to pay attention to that, right? You know, founders come from all sorts of places, and really, if anything, a lot of our older founders bring a lot more experience. So.
Go ahead.
Yep. Next winter, just about 2 years, I think, after having to scale it down a little bit. So the question is, what did you learn from scaling it down that allowed you to scaling it up now?
Well, all of us at YC, we're engineers. So basically, when something breaks, we try to dial it back a little bit, retool, and then try to dial it back up to test where, you know, where stress points might be. So we're going to find out. One of the things that we spend a lot of time doing is actually increasing our partner base. So, you know, just yesterday we brought on Michael Seibel, who is the CEO of Justin TV. Ilya from Pars came on as a part-time partner. So we're continuing to kind of expand our staff. And, you know, basically we also split up the 100 companies into subgroups of about 25. And that's going to help as well. So I guess we'll see. But we feel pretty good about these companies. You know, one thing that we have really tried to do is keep the quality bar constant. And so, you know, this last time, part of the reason why we let in more companies is actually the number of applicants we got went from 3,000 to 5,000. And so what we worried was we would actually be remiss. We would actually do the wrong thing by reducing the number of companies on a percentage basis. Like, if we throw out one of those outliers, then that's one less startup that could really matter.
Having achieved substantial financial success, do you foresee selecting any companies that have a small market and a market that will never grow? I'm thinking of people with physical challenges, mentally impaired people. You know, there are some very serious societal needs, but they will never have big markets.
Well, one thing that we do is YC has, for about a year now, we've been investing in nonprofits, which we really do hope will kind of help society in general. You know, one of our best companies actually turned out to be WOTC.org, which is a crowdfunding platform for paying for the medical needs of people in need. And so, you know, that's one of the ways that we really do want to help. And, you know, it's kind of an ongoing dialogue. We're always looking for more ways to help in that way.
Is it just charitable contribution you make?
We actually bring them into the program. And so essentially what we've been trying to do is find nonprofits that have some sort of self-sustaining aspect to them. And WOTC's great because it's got a crowdfunding aspect. There's another company called Nora Health. It's actually a nonprofit. And it has sort of a revenue generation arm that they sell to the first world, and then they, a lot of the nonprofit work is overseas. So there are lots of hybrid models and lots of approaches that we're always, you know, looking for, and we really want to fund those things too.
Where does the money that Y Combinator has to invest come from? How is that raised?
Well, a lot of that actually just came from the original partners at YC,
mm-hmm.
and so you know, roughly YC. If you just do the straight math.
You're not doing the VC thing and going out to financial institutions and getting limited partner money from them, or
yeah.
Is that happening too?
So one thing we did do recently is bring the YC VC program in-house, and so
mm-hmm.
that program does have limited partners,
okay.
But various well-known institutions.
Yeah, right.
And but in general, YC itself, we kind of view it as something that could turn into a university of sorts. We kind of think of it more so as an institution to help founders, to help create new companies, as opposed to an investor.
Yeah. So if we looked 10 years from now at the situation, do you think it would look the same? I mean, you would see the same dynamics, you would see the same kind of growth pattern, or is there anything that's going to break this?
It's a good question. Well, if we run into something that breaks it, we'll try to fix it. And what we do hope is not just 10 new companies that really matter come out, but maybe 100.
Yeah.